Good morning, ladies and gents. Glad to be here again with all of you in the last session already. And by way of a very short introduction, I wanted to share you an early morning fantasy and I had in my head about the theme of our panel today. What if Carmen was Hollywood cinema? With regisseur...
There's plenty of Hollywood movies.
As regisseur, I would pick out Quentin Tarantino. Salma Hayek would be Carmen, because she's of mixed Lebanese-Mexican descent, so that... And she's not a cigar maker, but a bullet maker. She's part of the Ammo Gals. I would choose Michael Dempsey as Don Jose, the Prince Charming. And he's from the Marine Corps. Escamillo for me would be Antonio Banderas, driving this posh convertible with bullet horns mounted on top of it. I think for me he would be kind of a hip hop star with golden teeth and the like. And then Michaela, I would choose Reese Witherspoon. She's a girl from the valley, as they call it, with some serious conservative values. And then as settings, I would choose first, of course, Las Vegas with Trump Tower in the distance. Then secondly, for Lila Spacia, I would choose the infamous Mustang Ranch, which is a barely legal brothel in Nevada, where Frasquita and the girls are engaged in lap dancing or that thing called twerking. Thirdly, Death Valley or the canyons. That would be the place where Trump's yet has to build a wall and they smuggle crack and the like over the border. And then we end up again in Vegas before the Circus Hotel with the outrageous display. And Don Jose has just heard that Escamillo's taking Carmen to Wedding Chapel. That infuriates him. So that would be the Hollywood movie Carmen 2017. Okay. Down to the serious facts. Charlotte Bentley is an HRC funded PhD student at the University of Cambridge, working under supervision of Dr. Benjamin Walton. A doctoral project explores the production and reception of French opera in New Orleans between 1819 and 1859. From October 2017, she will be a junior research fellow at Emmanuel College, Cambridge. Congratulations. The title of her paper is The Unstoppable March of Time, Carmen and New Orleans in Transition. Please welcome Charlotte Bentley.
So first of all, thank you very much to Claire and Dick for inviting me here. And it just struck me as I was writing this paper, which is sort of in its very early stages, how this has been a sort of cautionary tale for expecting what critics are going to say. So both Griot was born in New Orleans and Minnie Hawk was trained there for a while in her youth. And New Orleans tended not to forget things about its own musical life. And neither of them are mentioned at all in the first reviews of Carmen. So that completely blew my initial idea out of the water. But we've got something else here. So on the 21st of December, 1879, 3 days after the premiere of Carmen in New Orleans, the critic for the city's longest running newspaper interrupted his summary of the week's theatrical activities with this paragraph. In our century of progress, we're concerned above all with closing up distances. Soon, the urban railway lines, tramways in the Parisian style, will have a branch in Toulouse Street where numerous cars will be stationed, which will, from the exit of the theatre, be able to take audience members to their destination at Canal Street and this region that the old Creoles persist in calling the American sector. Thanks to this innovation, the opera will find itself linked directly by railways with all parts of the town. Initially, such a comment seems to have very little to do with Carmen, which was greeted by a packed auditorium of New Orleans' music lovers in their finery. On closer inspection, however, the critic's words capture a number of the most important issues that surrounded the work and the context of its premiere in the city, issues that were closely entwined with questions of progress and tradition. As we'll come to see, these discussions echoed in some respects the initial Parisian responses to Carmen, but also reflected specifically local concerns about the role of opera in the past, present, and future. In particular, in this paper, I want to position Carmen in post-Civil War New Orleans suggesting that the work reveals connections within an international operatic world and, at the same time, a rupture with the local operatic past. In this way, Carmen becomes both a wider representative of operatic culture in New Orleans in the post-Civil War period, and also a specific and particularly pertinent case study of the way that entangled local, national, and international interests shaped the reception of operatic works in the 19th century. So the city of New Orleans had a long-standing operatic tradition, which dated back to the end of the 18th century. From 1819 to 1859, the city's theatrical scene was dominated by the Francophone Théâtre d'Orléans, which you can see here, which was home to the first, and for some 35 years, the only permanent opera company in North America. Renowned at home and abroad for the opulence of its performances, as well as for the fact that its troupe was recruited each year from Europe, the theatre staged a variety of operatic genres and also spoken theatre for an eager public. It was responsible for giving the American premieres of many of the most important French operas of the 19th century. In 1859, troubled by disputes over the lease to the theatre building, the Théâtre d'Orléans troupe moved to a brand new French opera house located on the corner of Bourbon and Toulouse streets in the heart of the city's French Quarter. This impressive new opera house seated 2,000 people and was designed to cement New Orleans' position in an increasingly global operatic world. The best possible performers were recruited from Europe, and documents show in certain instances that even the Paris Opera was forced to wait for performers to finish their contracts in New Orleans before it could sign them. So French opera, of course, remained at the heart of the French Opera House repertoire, but it also staged Italian works, especially Verdi, in French translation, in response to a growing internationalization of operatic repertoire. During the seasons of 1859 to 1860 and 1860 to 61, it looked as if the New Orleans French Opera House was set to become a really major international opera house. Not only did the number and scale of productions continue to increase, but the manager, Charles Boudesquier, was always on the lookout for new talent. He managed, for instance, to engage a young Adelina Patti for several months in 1860. The outbreak of the American Civil War in April 1861, however, led to the closure of the opera house. And when the war ended in 1865, the situation looked very different. Boudesquier was not re-employed, and from that point on, the opera house was managed by a series of different directors, sometimes having its own troupe for a season, and sometimes playing host to visiting troupes for just a few months a year. So a real contrast with what had come before. This was the situation in which New Orleans' operatic life found itself when Carmen received its premiere at the French Opera House in December 1879. There was no permanent troupe that year, and the premiere was given in Italian and with recitatives by Max Strakosch's Italian Opera Company, a touring company which had come to New Orleans from New York via Philadelphia, and which had already performed Carmen elsewhere in the US in the previous season. So Strakosch's troupe had a series of 32 operas in its repertoire that season, as you can see from this slide, but New Orleans didn't get all of them during the troupe's visit. So comprising a mixture of French, Italian, and German works, all of these operas were performed in Italian translation. Such a move, of course, marked a break from the earlier tradition of the French opera house, in which all works were performed in French. The Strakosch troupe provided its own national level advertising in advance of its tours, producing for the season of 1879 to 1880 this little pamphlet, which I'm not sure how well you can see, but there's lots more pages to it than this. And it was designed to generate excitement in the lead up to the tour by listing the performers that Strakosch and his team had succeeded in securing so far, and also the repertoire of the troupe, which isn't really shown on those pages. The booklet assured prospective audience members of the quality of the productions they would see, with its thick glossy pages and statements that the chorus had been carefully selected from London's Italian Opera Covent Garden, as well as claims that the preparations for the season had cost in excess of $100,000. While the pamphlet had plenty to say about the performers, so everybody in the troupe gets at least a paragraph about them, it had very little to say about the works in the troupe's repertoire. And that's probably because all of them in this case had been heard before in America, if only in New York. Strakosch's principal lure in this piece of national advertising then lay in the stars that he had been able to secure for the season. Meanwhile, the local press in New Orleans encouraged readers to subscribe to Strakosch's season. The Daily Picayune, for example, wrote that Strakosch's troupe comprised fully 100 people, which includes a large orchestra and full chorus for the complete rendering of grand operas in a manner worthy of the palmy days of the old opera house, by which they mean the Théâtre d'Orléans, it was often referred to like that. Subscribers will also have the advantage of hearing the new operas Aida, Carmen, and Mephistopheles, in addition to some of the best of the great works that have been heard here before. Closer to the time, small notices advertising individual performances appeared in local newspapers. But there was little sense of press hype leading up to the work's premiere, and this for New Orleans was relatively unusual. There were a lot of works that had a lot of hype leading up to the premiere. Nonetheless, it seems that the English language press of New Orleans paid more attention to the approaching premiere of Carmen than the French. Since the beginning of the 19th century, New Orleans had published newspapers in both French and English. Some, such as the long-running La Bee, or The Bee, were bilingual, publishing sections in both French and English, which contained different material. Others, such as the Daily Picayune, which was published from the late 1830s on, were purely in English, as Anglophone citizens began to outnumber the city's French-speaking residents. The French opera had long been patronised by people from both linguistic groups, but generally only by the most aspirational members of Anglophone society, while the Francophone social mix was generally much larger. In the case of Carmen, the English language Daily Picayune published, alongside its adverts for the premiere, a summary of the opera's plot in order to encourage English speakers to buy tickets. The French language papers, on the other hand, clearly felt that it was unnecessary to publish the plot. After all, they'd been carrying references to Bizet and Carmen in the Parisian correspondence sections of their papers for the last few years, as well as in theatrical reports from New York following the opera's American premiere there in 1878. So yeah, that's just one of the many little notices that mention Carmen before the fact. Given the tensions that had waxed and waned between the city's Anglophone and Francophone residents over the 19th century, and which were finally starting to disappear as the city's French-speaking citizens diminished ever further in number, the fact that the French language newspapers felt it unnecessary to advertise Carmen with its plot is significant in that it seems to indicate the last vestiges of the Francophone belief that they were more attuned to the operatic world than their Anglo-American counterparts. When it came to reviewing the opera, neither La Bee or the Daily Picayune contained much specific information about the specifics of Strakosch's premiere of Carmen. And there is, to my knowledge, no definite surviving material related to this production. So Kristen has looked at a score, she's going to talk about it, that possibly was used by the troupe, but we can't really say for certain. Nonetheless, there is plenty of insight to be gained in various respects from the initial newspaper reviews, and I want to focus on two areas today. First is the critics' response to the character of Carmen. So Carmen was played in the New Orleans premiere by Anna de Bellocca, and she's not dressed as Carmen here, I think. she was a young protege of Strakosch's. He had introduced her to the American stage 4 years earlier, and he was proud to report in his publicity pamphlet that we saw earlier that since her American debut, she had gone on to win over audiences in Europe, saying that the progress she has made since that time has been marvelous. Nonetheless, she was described in his publicity materials, perhaps rather blandly, as a beautiful and charming young artiste. It appears that it was not only this description of Bellocca that was bland. Her performance as Carmen was a source of major criticism for the French language press in New Orleans. While the reviewer for the English language Daily Picayune barely passed comment on Bellocca and her performance, the French language reviewers in La Bee were more openly critical. One review stated that although she'd made a very pretty Carmen and had received many flowers from the audience, he complained that she lacked a bit of meridional fire and couleur locale. Another, two days later, stated that she did not represent for us Mérimée's Carmen, demanding more sunshine and Spanish blood from the performance. In other words, the New Orleans reception of Carmen as a character couldn't have been further from the work's initial Parisian reception, where she was found to be pretty shocking. For the critics of New Orleans, there was not enough of Mérimée's brown girl of the mountains, a gypsy, savage though generous in her allures, wild even in her impulses, capricious in her affections. They got quite carried away saying what they wanted Carmen to be. But then they were a bit sad that the Carmen presented to them by Bellocca was too pretty and refined. These criticisms of a sanitized Carmen were not, it seems, leveled particularly at Bizet or his librettists, but rather specifically against Bellocca's performance. the New Orleans French language press had also made similar criticisms of her performance as Azucena in Verdi's Il Trovatore earlier in the week. The reviewer for La Baye felt that while a good performer should always sacrifice coquettishness to realism, Belocca was too much a coquette. The moral sensibilities of the Francophone critics of New Orleans, it seems, were not as easily offended as those of Paris, in spite of the fact that the French Opera House had come to provide much the same social context as the Opera Comique in Paris. The opera had become a location for social visits of the city's wealthier classes by this point, and there wasn't really an aristocratic elite in New Orleans in the same way as there was in Europe. And it was a place for families and even for children. While the New Orleans critics didn't want realism to get out of hand, and one of them suggested that Baldanza's Don José would benefit from a little less realism and a little more poetry, they felt that the opera in its performance by the Strakosch troupe lacked passion and fire. In contrast, when the same production was heard back in New York just over a month later, the New York Times proclaimed that Mademoiselle Belocca's voice is suited to the music and her personal attractions add a charm which is very much in keeping with the character. Her Carmen was quite enough for New Yorkers. In such differences of opinion, then, we find a key element of the New Orleans reception of Strakosch's Carmen. This Carmen was perhaps altogether too northern for them. Indeed, in some ways, it seemed to remind them that the operatic tradition of which they were once so proud, and which had inspired the critic for the Daily Picayune to muse nostalgically on the palmy days of the old opera house in the quotation we saw before, was no more, and that they had to rely on imported opera from the northern cities. To make matters worse, Carmen was an opera which had numerous resonances for the people of New Orleans. Not only was it a French work, which they had to hear in Italian, but it played upon themes of Spanishness and the passions of the Hot South, both of which had a particular kind of meaning for New Orleans, as a southern city which had been ruled by Spain from 1763 to 1803, and which was constantly being characterized within America as this place of heat and passion. The Carmen with which Strakosch presented them, however, seemed altogether too sanitized and temperate for their tastes. The press criticisms of the production perhaps hint not only at a sense of shame among the reviewers that New Orleans had come to rely on the North for its operatic life, but also reflected wider tensions in society at the end of the Reconstruction period, as the Civil War had ensured that the South and its old ways gave way to the North in political, economic, and, it seems, operatic life. This newfound reliance of New Orleans on the North for its operatic fare was revealed in other respects too, particularly when it came to the reception of Bizet's music. The critic for the Daily Picayune, for example, confessed that he was a little disappointed by the music, saying that it, and I quote, did not at its first hearing produce the impression which, from the eulogies of it made by the Northern press, was anticipated. The reviewer saw Carmen as a sort of mosaic with reminiscences of grand opera, comic opera, and opera bouffe, which as a whole is pleasing, but which does not draw from the public that outburst of applause which Verdi's or Meyerbeer's music never fails to do. Nonetheless, he concluded that Carmen was to be retained long on the boards, and that, as was befitting of the great work they'd prepared themselves to hear, further listenings would most likely bring about greater understanding and appreciation. For the Francophone critic of La Baye, however, his touchstone for the reception of Carmen doesn't seem to have been the Northern press, although reprints of reviews from opera seasons in New York often appeared in that paper. Instead, with long-established precedent in New Orleans theatrical criticism, the Parisian reception became their point of departure. Of course, as is well known, Carmen had been criticized in Paris as too symphonic or Wagnerian, and had been seen as sort of degrading the national French genre of opera comique. The Francophone reception in New Orleans tapped into some of that language of this earlier reception, with the critic for La Baye indeed describing as Carmen as symphonic. He took a rather more philosophical tone to the same musical traits that had caused consternation in Paris in 1875, however. He reflected that it's part of human nature to, and I quote, lament the loss of things that have delighted us, but it's part of the movement and development of life that art should not stand still in a given form. The opera comique, beloved of our fathers, and it was very striking that there was a very similar quotation in Claire's paper yesterday, the opera comique, beloved of our fathers, has ceased to exist, although the most brilliant examples of this genre should remain for a long time on the stage. He continued explaining how operetta and mixed compositions, which he says are composed in the old manner but displaying influences of the symphonic school, have now come to dominate. Carmen, he says, belongs to that latter mixed category. He then addressed the Parisian critics directly, saying that they can no more eternalise a genre in art than they can know how to stop time. While he didn't enjoy everything about Carmen, he felt that the first act and its recitatives needed a much higher level of performance to stave off monotony, for example. He took a determinedly forward-looking approach to the work, saying that it produced an effect which explains the success it's obtained everywhere. But there's something about his wording here that has a distinct lack of personal response to the work and suggests more a kind of resigned acceptance than genuine pleasure at this fact. His words are quite revealing in several respects. Firstly, he shows not only how New Orleans' operatic reception was influenced both by other American reviews and by Parisian ones, as of course had been the case for almost half a century by the time Carmen arrived in the city. Furthermore, the review reveals how the New Orleans critic felt able to challenge the Parisian critics in certain respects and to try and position himself as progressive in some way. Articles from L'Abbé and other New Orleans news sources sometimes found their way into the Parisian press, so the New Orleans critic knew that there was a chance that his words might even be read in Europe. The reception of Carmen in New Orleans then was influenced by international operatic and press connections, and also in some way sought to shape them. New Orleans was not prepared simply to copy what either New York or Paris had said, but to try and respond to them. But the New Orleans critics' discussions of the music once again also had important local context. While their comments on the loss of opera comique, of course, had resonances with both the generic and institutional betrayal that some Parisian critics read into the work, they also had much to say about the local operatic tradition. Opera comique had been the mainstay of New Orleans' operatic life for the first 40 years of the 19th century, and these are some of the most enduringly popular ones, but obviously there are some later ones that get added to the end of the list as well. And from the 1830s, these older opera comiques had shared centre stage with productions of French grand operas. But now that the French opera house had no permanent troupe of its own and relied on touring companies, this steady diet of traditional opera comique seemed to disappear, and Italian comic works took its place. The Civil War then had effectively stripped the city of its old operatic tradition, and the future emerging from this period of reconstruction, operatic as well as socio-political, looked very different. And so we return to the question of progress with which this paper began. And here is a picture of a man waiting for the tram outside the Opera House once it was finished. The reception of Carmen's premiere in New Orleans finds an analogue in that digression in the Revue for L'Abbé, which described the technological progress being made by the city of New Orleans and the increasing interconnectedness of life in all parts of the city. The Opera House was now to be accessible from more distant parts of the city than ever before, but the operatic tradition that it represented had been fundamentally altered. Nonetheless, the critic for L'Abbé chose to look to the future rather than back to the past. If society must progress, so too must its art, he claimed. And he felt that there was little point in dwelling exclusively on the past, even as the shadow of the city's old operatic tradition hovered over his report. Carmen, as a new and increasingly popular French work, displaying in many ways a break with an earlier school of French operatic composition, became a way through which the Francophone critics of New Orleans, themselves an increasingly rare breed, could express New Orleans' position in the post-Civil War era. In their criticism of the opera, their desire to participate in an international operatic world, and their desire to engage with changing local and national contexts of operatic performance came together. So there is a lot more still to do. This was just a little initial idea. A few months after the Strakosch premiere, the opera was presented again to the city, in English this time, by Emma Abbott's touring English opera company. And there are a number of materials relating to this slightly later production, which Kristen is going to talk about in her paper. I'll leave her to talk about all of that. And then my final thought, which I haven't really... Oh yeah, so here's some of the things that Kristen might be talking about. There's this little production, which in 1881, Leavitt's English opera Burlesque...
It's from London.
Yes, so exactly. It was a London production, which had also been to New York, and now appears in New Orleans in 1881, which is just lovely because Don José and various others are played by women, and then Micaela's played by man, which all just seems very funny. And they've got hilariously bad descriptions about them, which were presumably funny in 1881, but something is a little bit lost over time. So yeah, it would be lovely to look at this production and how the people of New Orleans felt about it, but it's one of those things that I found with New Orleans all the way along the line. You either get a little tantalizing glimpse of material like this and then no reception at all, or you get it the other way around. So yeah, this is something that I'll still be looking about. These other later productions, though, can at least emphasize that Carmen did become a regular fixture on stages across New Orleans, as the critic for the Daily Picayune had predicted. Something about the flexibility of her character and also of Bizet's music meant that the opera was ripe for adaptation and reinterpretation to suit the needs and tastes of these diverse audiences. So, thank you.
Thank you for this wonderful paper. Again, illustrating the cross-Atlantic connections that were so incredibly rapid and that are incredibly interesting, because Strakosch was a name that sounded a bell to me, and I found out that Phebea Strakosch was a singer at the Monet. So, and luckily I have my memory prosthesis with me, to find out that actually there were three brothers, one of whom was married to Carlotta Patti, sister of. So, how.
And that Strakosch married Clara Louise Kellogg later on. And so, that Max Strakosch, and there was an Ecker who was a nephew. It was a big family.
So, but at any rate, itinerant troops for the 19th century are not well studied, are they? Better actually in the 18th century. And I assume there are questions here.
Before the questions, I just wanted to pick up on your point about how rapidly operatic works are moving. Just to say that for New Orleans, this was actually quite a slow transfer, that it was used to earlier in the 19th century getting works incredibly rapidly. So like Meyerbeer's Le Prophète was performed pretty much 12 months to the day after its Parisian premiere in New Orleans, which is just astonishingly fast. So this again was a bit of a come down for them in that respect. They'd been used to being really on top of what was happening in Paris.
Thank you, Charlotte. So that before the Civil War, they met performed in French.
Yeah.
So do you know when Carmen was sung in French?
No, so that's something that I've not yet come across. So. I should say about sort of the searching the newspapers for this kind of thing. The Daily Picayune does have a text searchable thing, which is not very good, but at least can give you a few things to sort of get started on. L'Abbé, which is much more detailed and carries a lot more theatrical news, doesn't have, it's all digitized, but the print quality is absolutely appalling and there's no kind of searchable function. So it's a very time consuming process to try and go through and zoom in on it all and try and get it in focus. But I'm going to keep looking. It seems like it was a lot later.
So they started performing in Italian then after the Civil War?
Yeah, it seems to have, actually the second production that they got was actually in English.
It depends on who was coming through.
It does. They had a few years where they did have an opera company that was got up specifically for the French Opera House and would stay just there and do a season, didn't tour anywhere else. And they tended to do Carmen in Italian as well for quite a few years. So I'm not actually sure when the first French productions.
I'm doing some work at the moment with this French traveling pianist who came to America in 79. Mm-hmm. And on the ship coming from the Havre, there was a French opera troupe on their way to New Orleans, and they were singing on board ship. And that was, he thought they were pretty bad. But they were singing in French, so I would imagine they sing in Italian then, and they got to New Orleans.
Well, no, I mean, I don't actually, what time in 1879 was that?
October?
Now that's really surprising,
yeah.
Because the French Opera House was just occupied by Strakosch's troupe in this autumn period. So I don't know if the date.
I don't know of any French production in America in 1870.
No.
No.
They must have been singing. But they were singing in French on board ship.
On board ship?
Yeah.
How unusual.
It's
yeah.
I wish I knew what company that was. He's published his book. It's Kowalski à travers la Marie.
You're going to have to write that.
Elizabeth?
Michael has joined us, and he's read your paper.
Hello, Michael.
He's wondering if there's anything in the reception at all of the Habanera specifically, or performances with that aria, and did they identify with it, because he's obviously thinking of the Gottschalk connection, Gottschalk from New Orleans, and how important all of that is.
Yeah, so a few of the reviews, they mention it as one of the nice bits of the opera that they like, but they don't engage with it further. I mean, what's really struck me about this reception of Carmen, particularly in the French press, is almost this kind of resigned indifference to it, which is really, really surprising. Mm-hmm. Like, comments like that one that I had that are completely impersonal, like, it will become a fixture on our stages, and this sort of thing, that they, it's almost as if they feel that it doesn't matter what they say about it, because they know that this work is going to come to them, and that, I mean, the audience loved it. It was packed out for every night that Carmen was performed, and it's almost this sense among the critics of, it really doesn't matter what they say any longer about this, because the work's going to come, whether they like it or not, which I was really surprised about, because so often with these French works that they get, there's been such excitement and really a sense of how important this is for the local people. And I just can't help but feel that it is because it's being brought to them by this travelling troupe that they're just a bit offended by the whole business. No, so there's nothing that emerges in this early reception in New Orleans. It's not the case in other places, as we might hear a bit later on. But again, like, New Orleans has had a very kind of interesting theatrical tradition up to this point, because for a long time before the Civil War, the theatre was very surprisingly open, so slaves were permitted to sit in the top gallery of the theatre, and there was a whole gallery reserved for the free people of colour who were major patrons of the theatre, that theirs was always the section where everybody was queuing for tickets and they were turning people away. And there were always complaints that, you know, the white women of New Orleans never came and their area was always empty, but it was really heavily patronised by black people. And then, of course, after the Civil War, all of that has been shaken up so much, but I can't say whether it's a deliberate attempt to keep any kind of racial discourse out of this reception, but certainly things have changed a lot at this point. Sorry, I can't answer that. It's just that it was the only photograph of her that I could find. So if anybody knows any more about this...
So you don't know whether it's what it's from, whether it was a postcard
or... No, I mean, I think it was the way it looked where I found it made it look as if it had been a carte de visite.
Okay.
And
not necessarily from New Orleans and that period.
Yeah, not from New Orleans.
I just think the fan, the flower in the hair, the flower in the hand, and the fact that she's wearing something that's like a mantilla.
Yeah,
you know,
I mean,
it's just a little bit Spanish. It's not the way we envisage Carmen in this period, but I think those are cues. I don't know if you'd agree, Lola, of her Spanishness.
Yeah, I mean, she might be a sort of interesting character to follow up on, because all I know about her is that she's actually Russian, but has, you know... but that she's sort of adopted this name that makes her sound a bit weird. But yeah, no, I'd like to find out a bit more about her, because she certainly wasn't favoured by the New Orleans critics in any role where she was supposed to be playing a gypsy. They liked her because they didn't like her in Il Trovatore either. But then they did like her in things where she was much more kind of straight laced and. Which is,
it's a beautiful image, and it's lovely, the look on her face. I mean, it's just gorgeous.
Yeah. I don't know if she lived long enough, but to me, she looks so much like some
Tutsa.
She's very, you know, it's it could be Spanish, but it's so Sicilian as well because
yeah.
of this heavy load and black
yeah.
and
yeah, exactly.
very like, you know, super Catholic.
Yeah,
you know, it's a very Catholic pose. It's
yeah.
not so, but I don't know if she lived long enough
no.
to have seen the symptoms, so.
Yeah, I mean, I really don't know anything more about her. I looked and couldn't.
I think you said, Charlotte, that Strakosz said that he recruited his troop in London?
Well, he'd recruited the chorus that
right.
he'd got from, he apparently took the whole chorus from
Covent Garden.
So he says.
okay, so not the solo singers.
Well, not necessarily,
okay.
not that he always says, but it was the chorus.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Charlotte. Second paper will be read by proxy, as they say,
yeah.
presented.
I shall do my second pregnant woman of the
Yes. Tamara Thompson earned a PhD in musicology from Royal College of Music in London as an RCM scholar. The current research focuses on the works of Jules Massenet, Camille Saint-Saëns, and Georges Bizet. As a performance artist, Tamara has become known for her soaring lyric coloratura soprano voice and bell-like tone. Performance engagements include appearances with Nevada Opera Works, St. John's Elsham, Toccata Orchestra, and Sierra Nevada Chorale. She has recorded new works and premiered critical editions for composers in the United States and Europe. Dr. Thompson is an adjunct professor at Point Loma Nazarene University in the Department of Education, serving as a research mentor to postgraduate educators. An active vocal pedagogue, she teaches genres from classical to contemporary. And the title of her paper is Carmen in the Wild West.
Okay, so Tamara sent me she sent a PowerPoint with some information. So I don't have a full paper to read to you, so I won't take the full time, which means we get tea early, or coffee early. But I have got a PowerPoint, and I've got some sort of general first information that she sent along, so I thought it was interesting for us to hear it now. So, that's the welcome slide. Do I have to do another slide? So, the globe-trotting aspects of Carmen deserve abundant attention. Boasting a rich tapestry of music, dance, drama, the opera became part of each city's landscape in original ways. From the languages presented, French, Italian, English, and German, spoken dialogue and recitative, costume design and staging, and outright plot changes, the opera has proven to be highly adaptable and continually alluring. This paper focuses on the United States premise of Carmen west of the Mississippi River, meaning west of New Orleans, St. Louis, and Chicago. Colonel James Henry Mapleson and his 140-strong troop from Her Majesty's Italian Opera, as we know, left London to mount the first US tour in the 78-79 season, gaining most positive reception during the initial tour, despite the mounting fiscal and workforce tensions of his company, which the press also wrote about. Mapleson followed up with subsequent visits, but his reign as American's Pied Piper of Italian opera ended shortly after the San Francisco premiere of Carmen in 1886. During the company's trip, the US received its first stage Carmen on the 23rd of October 1878 at the Academy of Music in New York City, sung in Italian. Mapleson's tour began in New York, then travelled to Baltimore, Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, Cincinnati, Boston, Chicago, and St. Louis. The troupe presented 164 operatic performances and 47 concerts between October 1878 and February 1879. Carmen saw the stage 26 times, making it the most performed opera in their repertoire. Lucia came in second with 20 performances, and La Sonnambula took third with 19 performances. She's just put down here, notice the Met production in 1892. The different languages was because Marie Tavary played Carmen as a last minute replacement, and she sang in German. Emma Ames sang Michaela in French, and the rest of the cast sang in Italian. So, and it was the only performance of Carmen at the Met that season. American soprano Minnie Hook played the title role and blatantly took credit for the success of this Carmen production, claiming that she had chosen the principals and staging manager herself, and I quote, is this the right slide? Am I on the right slide?
Yeah, I am on the right side.
Yes, I'm on the right side. Ooh. Well, we'll have her as well. Mr. Mapleson had given me carte blanche to choose the artist for Carmen. La Piscida, stage design, who had come over from Brussels, thought my choice excellent. They had been singing most purely Italian music in front of the footlights without making any effort to act the parts. To deviate from the traditional windmill acting of to the average Italian singer would surely mean disaster. They looked as though they were being drilled for optic telegraphy or railroad switching. They stood, to all appearances, nailed to the boards, and every high note was accompanied by the raising of their arm, their right arms. We've had that before, haven't we? This would never do for Carmen. In Brise's opera, natural action, life, and varied movements meant as much as the singing, one blending into the other. And when, at the first stage rehearsal, I objected to the old-fashioned Italian switch signals, they, one and all, shook their heads and predicted that Carmen would be a deadly failure. Hawke went further, praising herself for the success of every subsequent company's production of Carmen, claiming that her interpretation became the die from which all following Carmens had been cast. Although many American critics disapproved of the sinfulness of Carmen's character, most offered praise of Hawke and the cast for their artistry. Carmen, the character, symbolized ungodliness and was reviled. The trend in US productions of painting Carmen in a subhuman light continued into the early 20th century. By the time Olle Fremstadt took the role as Carmen in 1906, in the 1906 San Francisco opera production with Caruso as Don José, the costumers dressed her in a less ornate attire, and the artist and stage director made her characterization more calculated and cold. Fremstadt did not receive positive reviews for her portrayal. In fact, her representation of the usually sensualist character was deemed to be stiff and dutchy by local critics. I'm not quite sure what that means. It seemed these reviewers loved to hate the repugnant gypsy witch, and Fremstadt failed to provide enough fodder for their vitriolic diatribes. And we'll come back to the Fremstadt Caruso version of Carmen in a bit. But we're going to go back to the Colonel, Mapleson, and his artiste. Now, there's a little bit I'm going to miss out because it quotes Kristen, so I'll leave Kristen to quote Kristen. and lead straight on. So hang on, is there a slide? So Mapleson returned to the US repeatedly, but it was not until the 1885-86 tour that the company finally ventured far west. He assembled an entourage of 160 personnel. Larger salary demands combined with disastrous receipts in New York sent the troupe into the rest of the tour underfunded and led by a discouraged impresario. It should have served as an omen heralding the tribulations to come. In early 1886, the troupe covered more than 13,000 miles and offered nearly 100 performances. The train cars inhabited by Her Majesty's Opera Company reached San Francisco in March, after encountering a snowstorm that had washed out the railway in Truckee, California, a small town high in the Sierra Nevada mountains between Reno, Nevada, and Sacramento, California. Truckee is best known as the site of the Donner Party catastrophe of 1846, if anybody knows what that is.
Oh, it's when they ate each other. They got stuck up in the mountains in a terrible snowstorm, and they couldn't get out, and they were starving to death, and they started cannibalizing.
Thank you.
That's what it is. So good comment.
So given the propensity of Mapleson singers towards hysteria, one can imagine the chaotic and dramatic scene that ensued once the train came to a halt. San Franciscans showed great enthusiasm at the company's arrival, but the mounting tensions between the divas and divos of Her Majesty's Opera Company added to the stresses with which Mapleson struggled. Hawke commented in her memoirs that she joined the company for the rest of that tour in spite of the dire state of the Colonel's finances and the poor treatment of the staff. Her description of the working conditions reveals an interesting juxtaposition between the opulent Palace Hotel accommodations to which Mapleson had become accustomed and the squalor of his his employees suffered. The most famous story from any of the company's US tours occurred during this 1885-86 season. The resulting lawsuits carried on for quite some time. Mapleson recounted the evening. We went to Chicago, opening very successfully with a performance of Carmen, when a violent scene occurred in the middle of the third act when Don José Ravelli was about to introduce an effective high note, which generally brought down the house, that Carmen, Hawke, rushed forward and embraced him. Why? I could never understand. Being interrupted at the moment of his effect, he was greatly enraged, and by his movement showed that he had resolved to throw Madame Hawke into the orchestra. But she held firmly onto his red waistcoat, he shouting all the time, "Laissez-moi, laissez-moi," until all the buttons came off one by one, when she retired hastily to another part of the stage. Ravelli rushed forward and exclaimed, "Regardez, elle a déchiré mon gilet!" And with such rage that he brought down thunders of applause, and the people believing this genuine expression of anger to be part of the play. Am I on the right slide?
I'm not sure I am. Was that all about that?
Yeah. Okay. Hawke pleaded complete innocence. Ravelli's violent eruption scared the singer and her husband so much that they sought legal counsel immediately. Mapleson had to post a $2,000 bond guaranteeing appropriate conduct by Ravelli and protection for Hawke. It is rumoured that the Baron stood in the wings with a revolver, ready to defend his bride should the tenor have another outburst. The reception of San Francisco's first Carmen appears to have been lukewarm. While direct reviews from the opening night on the 22nd of March 1886 were worded politely, a review in the San Francisco Chronicle, published on the 25th of March 1886, extols the virtues of the previous night's performance, which was the San Francisco premiere of Massenet's Manon with Hawke in the title role, while blatantly dismissing the opening nights of Carmen on the 22nd of March and Lucia di Lammermoor on the 23rd of March. Hawke claimed a case of fatigue caused her lackluster opening night of Carmen. So financial trouble, murder, natural disaster, death, law enforcement, attorney, sickness, rebellion, rivalry, and travel delays tarnished the 1885-1886 American tour of Her Majesty's Opera Company, leaving Colonel Mapleson stressed and without funds, but artistically satisfied. Got to be something in it. The troupe San Francisco season yielded 24 opera performances and 3 Sunday concerts. Mapleson eventually made his way to London and never returned to the United States. San Francisco struck the final blow. Minnie Hawke eventually retired to her home near Lucerne in Switzerland. At the end of her life, she reached out to Americans for financial support when she had lost her vision and could not pay her late husband's debts. But perhaps it was the curse of Carmen in the Wild West, a formidable foe who would deal opera yet another losing hand 20 years later. Like Mapleson, San Francisco managed to scare off another notable music maker. In April 1906, world-renowned tenor Enrico Caruso arrived in the Golden West to sing Don José in the Metropolitan Opera Tour production of Carmen. Swedish-American soprano Olive Fremstadt played Carmen. Following Mapleson's tradition, the cast took up residence at the Palace Hotel. They opened the night of the great 1906 San Francisco earthquake. At 5 a.m., the earth shook, and the city was hit by an earthquake that measured 8.3 on the Richter scale. It was the largest natural disaster to hit the U.S. in the 20th century. I don't know Olive Fremstadt for now. Aside from the historic significance of the intersection between Carmen, Caruso, and the great San Francisco earthquake, the catastrophic event provides an explanation, however unfortunate, for the relatively small amount of surviving primary source documents related to the San Francisco productions of Carmen 1886 to 1906. So basically, that's what Tammy has sent us. She said that, you know, she's got so much she wants to do, so much she's planning to do. The visits to Berkeley, to Stanford Libraries, to the University of Wisconsin, at Madison, to the New York Public Library, and she's hoping that some of the records she will find there will be used to build the sort of descriptions of the late 19th century Carmen productions that appeared in the American Wild West. So thank you very much.
soundbite on that previous
There
slide?
Was.
Yes.
I did, but I'm not sure we set the link up.
Right.
I can try it. I don't think we set the link up, Dick, so we can hear it later on if we want to.
That's a lovely icon.
Okay, so I'll leave that there.
There's no Skype link.
Wait, it's too early in the morning
yes,
for Tammy.
Yes.
No, I'm afraid it's 3 o'clock in the morning for her. Mm. So
no.
That's
and pregnant.
And
that's
and Tammy's pregnant.
Okay, then we go to the third and already last paper of this session by Kristen Turner, who received her doctorate in musicology from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, with a dissertation on class and American operatic culture at the turn of the 20th century. She teaches in the music department at North Carolina State University in Raleigh, North Carolina. Her work on opera in the United States has been published in the Journal of the Society for American Music, Journal of Musicological Research, and in an interdisciplinary collection edition titled Gender and the Representation of Evil. With support from the Society of American Music and the National Endowment of the Humanities, Dr. Turner is currently working on a monograph about the use of opera in American popular staged musical entertainments as a symbol for issues of identity. The title of her paper is Half Wild, Self-Willed, Reckless, and Rebellious, Common in America. Please welcome Kristen Turner.
I'm so excited to be able to wrap up our papers and to once again thank Claire and Dick for bringing us all together. And I know I've learned so much, and I'm sure everyone else is feels the same. So thank you so much for bringing us all together. So as we've already heard, Carmen was premiered in the United States and during the 1878-79 season, but that Her Majesty's Italian Opera Company production started in London, then came to America, and this is something that Her Majesty's Italian Opera Company did several times, starring Minnie Hopkins, some pictures there. It premiered on October 23rd, 1878, but there was another Italian opera production, second company, the Strakosch Company, which at the time was headed by or starring Clara Louise Kellogg. She was playing Carmen, but she wasn't with the company the next season when Strakosch went to New Orleans that season. So we have these dueling productions, and it was, I think, in fact, the slide from tomorrow's paper was not quite right in that the October 23rd is Her Majesty's Italian Opera Company, and then October 25th is when Strakosch performed in Philadelphia, also in Italian. So you had these two dueling productions going throughout America. Both performances starred American-born divas who had studied in Europe and did not perform in the U.S. until they'd made their professional reputations overseas. Both companies traveled around the country, stopping at any town along the railroad that could accommodate a troupe of their size. The U.S. papers reviewed each performance, kept up on the latest opera gossip, and relentlessly compared the productions and the relative merits of Hauk and Kellogg's performances. All of this was entirely normal for the United States. There were no professional residential opera companies anywhere in the United States in 1878. And as Charlotte said, New Orleans was completely an outlier in ever having a long-term residential opera tradition. Nowhere else had anything like that. So despite the genre's great popularity across the socioeconomic spectrum, without any governmental or philanthropic support for opera, there was no city that could support a long-term, full-time opera company. Even the Metropolitan Opera, which performed Carmen during its debut season in 1883, was really a touring company, assembled by an impresario hired by the Metropolitan Opera House's board of directors. The company went on tour once its contract with the house was fulfilled. It wasn't really till sometime after World War I that you have the kind of Metropolitan Opera Company that we have today. So their production materials, well, there was a lot of stuff that got destroyed in 1906, but it's all belonged to that impresario. It didn't stay at the house. Because peripatetic companies produced opera with international casts, organized by producers who ran their troops outside of musical institutions, I'm not aware of any American production documents from the 19th century that have anything like the provenance of documents you might find in a European opera, a long-term great opera house in Europe. Thus, when reconstructing operatic performance practices in the United States before World War I, we must rely on sources that can be difficult to interpret and have passed through many hands. The best resources we have for this sort of investigation are the production materials once owned by the Thames Widmark Company and now housed at the Mills Music Library at the University of Wisconsin at Madison. The business was formed when the Arthur Thames Company, which was always a lending organization, founded in 1885, merged in 1925 with a lending library maintained by the Widmark & Sons Music Publishing House. In the 1960s, the company deposited much of their old inventory at the Mills Music Library and a few other American archives. But the interesting Carmen stuff, in my opinion, is all at Madison, having looked at some of the other stuff. And Thames Widmark is still around today. They're a licensing house. You can still rent material from them. So it's a very successful concern still. Now, I've given you a handout. That handout, as you can see, there are 16 piano vocal scores for Carmen in this collection, plus a lot of orchestral parts, and then some, there's part books, and there's a little bit of other information as well, and prompt books, and all sorts of, quite a lot on Carmen, actually. Now, some of you have read my dissertation already, and you'll see that the top five scores are the ones that I focused on for my dissertation. So if you've read my dissertation, that's what it's on. And I chose those five because I could date them by who had used them first. And the other scores are harder to date, but I've tried to line them up in what I think is approximately chronological order from when they would have been used. There are Arthur Thames gathered his collection by buying the scores of other people. So that's why the name, so I think those names are the score, who owned them first. And I think Widmark might have done that as well, at least sometimes, but I don't have as good an information for Thames, for Widmark as I do for Thames. There are three different editions. There's the Metzler score, that first London-based score, which only has English lyrics and no dialogue, just recitatives. The Ditson is an American publishing company. It's an Italian-English score, has both recitatives and dialogue. And then the Schirmer score is French-English. And you'll see that sometimes it says Schirmer 1895, but I say it hasn't been used till after 1910. That's because in some of them there is one of the choruses in Act 4 is copyrighted by itself as 1910, so it couldn't have been printed till after that. So stage manager scores have staging instructions either handwritten in the source, as in the case of the Young and Abbott scores, or they have sheets interwoven into the score with production details, which is true of both Widmark sources, which are a bit later. It's hard to see, but so they have these white pages and then all the information with little, sometimes they'll have like little symbols that tell you where in the score that you should be doing whatever they're telling you to do. Director's scores may have some staging instructions, but primarily have marginalia for conductors, such as cues and reminders for time changes. Now, I've given you information on the back of this if you really care about all those people. But the thing that strikes me is that all of the people that I can identify in those earlier scores are only performed Carmen in English. And most of the other scores have indications in them that make me feel like they were performed by English companies and maybe never by Italian or French companies. For instance, in this score, this set six, this up here is different English underlay. So, and I don't have indications. So you can see right there. So I think that the majority of these scores were used by English language companies for sure. And I'm not sure they were ever used by foreign language companies. And one reason for that is those tended to be very large, and they probably had their own stuff. They didn't need to rent them, even in these later time periods. And so I feel most comfortable in saying what I have found and what I'm about to tell you about is an English language tradition. And whether it happened in other types of productions, I don't know, because I can't find scores. And the librettos are no help. They are all, they're all the same, and they don't seem to really indicate what actually happened in a production, the printed librettos that they would sell, you know. So this, so I just wanted to give you that caveat. While these sources provide a wealth of information on Carmen performance practice in the US, they are difficult to decipher. Some of the scores don't seem to have been lent very often, or at least they have very few conflicting markings, and some are almost completely devoid of marginalia. So this is the Emma Abbott's director's score. There's a lot of markings, but hardly any erasures or changes or anything. Others contain evidence of repeated uses with many different, often confusing markings that clearly reflect multiple performances over many years. However, in combination with information from reviews and other printed commentary, I've been able to determine a common performance tradition for American English language productions that developed beginning in about 1880, or a little after 1880. Unfortunately, I cannot definitively determine from reviews if foreign language productions follow these performing conventions. Some of the adjustments in the Tamms Widmark scores, and most, if not all, the cuts in Emma Abbott scores seem to reflect practical considerations. So back to Emma Abbott. For instance, many companies didn't tour with children, so the boys' choir parts are largely excised. So here's all the instrumental stuff. As soon as the boys come in, boom, it's gone. Right? And so basically, that in her score, they did all the instrumental stuff, cut out any repeats, took out all the boys, and kept like a little bit of recitative, and that was it. And then they just moved on. Many cuts reduce repetition so that the audience would hear all the music but would only hear it once. This reduced the running time of the work as well as the strain on singers and orchestral musicians who often performed weeks of nightly performances while traveling during the day under difficult and tiring conditions and apparently fighting and, you know, the whole thing. The Abbott scores also don't seem to have been lent very often. They have few conflicting cuts, and they retain handwritten staging instructions that refer by name to singers who performed in the company's 1880 production, that one that came to New Orleans. In fact, that's the first time they ever performed the opera, was in that New Orleans production. And it's the first time, and the Emma Abbott production is the first company that did Carmen in English in the United States. So it's the first English production. Thus, the sources seem to preserve the earliest American English language production of Carmen. All the other sources that I have on this list contain another set of cuts and staging instructions that reveal a performance tradition for the work that subtly tailored Bizet's music to the American audience. So that's what I'm talking about today. Opera troupe staged a version of the work that intensified Carmen's vicious tendencies, highlighted Michaela's traditional femininity and heroic goodness, while amplifying Don José's masculinity in keeping with American critics' reading of the work. First, I'll explain the performance tradition I've identified, and then I'll give you more details of the American reception. And when I say American reception, what I mean by that is there's a set of critics in Chicago, Philadelphia, Boston, New York, and DC, whose work is reprinted all over the United States and is referred to by other critics in the larger cities that actually had music critics. So the lots of cities didn't have them. They might not see an opera for years at a time, but they kept up with what was happening in New York. So you could be in a town this big and know exactly what was on the New York and Philadelphia stages and what the critics thought about it. So what I'm giving you is that reading, but obviously there are regional differences, just like Charlotte was explaining. So I'm gonna give you sort of the 10,000 foot picture. Escamillo and Michaela's solo parts are rarely cut at all. Thus, the Toreador's boastful marches and Michaela's traditionally lyrical music, often described as Wagnerian by 19th century American writers, had the maximum possible impact on listeners. Don José's music was shaped to make him appear more masculine. For example, during Michaela and Don José's duet in Act One, Don José's arioso section, when he sings for a long time about his filial devotion, is almost always cut. Even in the 19th century, 5 minutes on how much a man loves his mother is not exactly macho behavior. Meanwhile, the score was cut in order to make Carmen appear more transgressive than she already is. In the Act Three card scene, for example, most of Frasquita and Mercedes' duet is omitted, which makes it appear as if Carmen is the only person who can read tarot cards, a skill associated with the cult. The other gypsy characters' parts are reduced, not just in this scene, but throughout the work, sometimes substantially, which isolates Carmen and serves to focus attention on the comparison to Michaela, which of course makes her just seem all the worse. No changes, however, are more important in shaping the meaning of the opera than the way that American companies performed the end of the work, beginning with the Act Three finale. During the closing minutes of the number, Carmen threatens Don José with a knife in every score that includes staging instructions. In all but two sources, she tries to stab him in the back, usually just as the curtain falls, and it is generally Michaela who stops her and saves Don José. So this is the Emma Abbott score, so this is the very first production. Here she is, she tries to stab in the back. In this production, it's Mercedes and Frasquita who take the knife away, but in all the others, it's Michaela who intervenes. The lone exceptions to this kind of staging are the Widmark stage manager scores. The production notes contain a slightly different description of a confrontation earlier in the finale, when Don José, now looking more masculine, I guess, catches Carmen trying to stab him and throws her to the ground or drags her and disarming her. So that's an example of that. Later, Michaela separates them before Carmen, who has retrieved her weapon, can attack him again. Handwritten notes in the Widmark number two, so this is Widmark number one, there's some handwritten notes in Widmark number two which reverses all that and goes back to the original staging where she actually tries to stab him in the back at the end of the act. Let's see. After the dramatic confrontation, when Michaela saves Don José from Carmen's homicidal intentions, American productions altered the beginning of Act Four to create a headlong rush toward Carmen's bloody end. According to the printed score, after the instrumental intermezzo, Act Four begins with two choral numbers, as we know. The first one introduces the village squares, a thrilling place of commerce and a popular meeting ground, but not much really happens. In many of the sources, the intermezzo is omitted or substantially cut, and the first chorus is skipped. The second chorus opens with boys hurrying on the stage to alert the townspeople that the Toreador's procession is arriving. Although the cuts are inconsistent, the scores shorten this number sometimes considerably. Thus, from the audience's perspective, for those productions that cut the intermezzo, the first chorus, most of the second chorus, the opera ends with Carmen trying to kill Don José, and very shortly after, Don José kills her in a murder that looks as much like a preemptive strike against a proven threat as a result of a jealous rage. The final music also does not escape unscathed. As the confrontation between Don José and Carmen becomes more heated, Carmen, according to the Ditson translation, proclaims, "No, I ne'er will yield me to thee," with a majestic run from high A flat down to low B flat. Bizet switches quickly from Carmen's cry of defiance to a short duet in which the characters restate their positions in the conflict, singing mismatched music. Don José's part is full of large leaps, making him sound almost hysterical, while Carmen, or maybe actually hysterical, while Carmen is generally calmer and more in control. Finally, Don José asks forlornly with almost no accompaniment, "Then thou lovest me no more," on repeated E naturals. The duet section then is excised, and in most of the scores, Carmen's powerful A flat run is also cut. So in other words, they cut somewhere starting around here, they cut all of this, they cut all of that, and they go straight to there. Okay. So Carmen, without that A flat run, loses this really exciting moment of power. It's just gone. Some sources allow Carmen the statement that she will never yield, like this Bostonian source, but they cut the duet and go straight from Carmen's theatrical two-active run to Don José's question, so from A to C, but no B. Cutting the duet, but not the run, creates a direct connection between Carmen's defiance and the moment when Don José decides to kill Carmen, or seems to. Once he's convinced that she doesn't love him, there's nothing to stop him from murdering her. American critics saw Carmen's rebelliousness as the main reason for Don Jose's actions, and this cut reinforces that interpretation. With the exception of the Abbott scores, again the first ones, the rest of those early scores, those first five scores on the list, also omit most of the choral interjections in the duet, so that the interruptions when the audience and the characters on stage hear the crowd cheering for Escamillo are almost completely absent. This keeps the audience's attention on Don Jose and Carmen, but means that Escamillo's offstage presence, which stokes Don Jose's jealousy and helps drive him to murder, is quite limited. Without the choral parts, Carmen's betrayal, rather than his envy of Escamillo, seems to be the prime factor in Don Jose's decision to kill her. So that's what I think they saw. Now, what did the critics think? Reviews from Europe were widely available in the United States, so American critics already had some idea of the reception of the work across the Atlantic before the premiere or before they saw the opera. And even the French and German ones were both widely available in translation and in the original, and the big critics almost all read German and most also read French, so they would have been able to access them easily. In some ways, the American reaction was similar to Europe. Critics thought Carmen was fundamentally evil and that she brought about her richly deserved death because she was half wild, self-willed, reckless, rebellious, impassioned, and withal a thoroughly vulgar gypsy girl. Despite this quotation, writers often did not seem to be particularly sensitive to the difference between Spanish and gypsy, and they would use those terms interchangeably. Instead, Carmen was described in ways most similar to stereotypes of African-American women, which comes to your point about race. One important American critic, Henry Craybill, even bizarrely asserted that the habanera is indubitably of African origin. As evil as Carmen was, Michaela, of course, was her opposite, the epitome of the true woman stereotype, who could be a role model for the perfect American woman, even though she was a little dull in comparison to the charismatic Carmen. Escamillo was all that a vigorous and vital man should be, while Don Jose was more of a cipher. American critics didn't want to call him weak or prone to violence, but it's hard to portray a murderer as the epitome of strong, manly virtue. Authors often avoided addressing his character altogether. But one memorable review from 1894 portrayed his deeply emotional response to Carmen's supposed provocations as proof of his masculinity, and the killing as a reflection of his strength of character as he fought to remove himself from Carmen's deadly influence. The critic, Carlton Hackett, commended Fernando de Lucia, who's the Don Jose he was talking about. He said, Lucia portrayed Don Jose in the way Bizet imagined him. Not a dainty picture from Our Lady's boudoir, but the laying bare of throbbing, suffering human heart, the pitiful story of a simple dragoon who touches the depth of despair and slays her who was the cause of it all. The question is, which came first, the American production and the reception, or the reception and then the production? My reading of the evidence is that American opera companies changed their performance as a result of the initial critical reaction, so 78, 79, 80 in there, that reaction, which only served to reinforce and amplify the American reception of the opera, so you get this endless loop, right? The Emma Abbott sources have many cuts for time, and that took into account her limited resources, but the strategic cuts I've described, this just now, and others like them are absent. The only major change from the printed score that's similar to the adaptations I've explained in the other sources, of course, is the stabbing, which is present in her stage guide. By the time the other scores were in use, the opera had been produced many times in the US, and performers had already had a chance to read the critics' responses. I do have evidence that companies did change productions based on critical feedback, at least some. The stabbing was such a common staging that American critics seemed to think that it was part of the original opera comique production. Emma Yook, who's an English language singer, who performed the work with her own company during the 1889-1890 season, was vilified by critics when she tried to soften her portrayal of Carmen and, among other things, omitted the stabbing. Critic and composer Arthur Well described this moment, so the moment of the stabbing, as a turning point in the opera. She jeers at the innocent peasant girl, Michaela, who brings the message that Don Jose's mother wants to see him, and thwarted in her attempt to escape, she tries to kill Jose when his back is turned. And then later he complains that she didn't do this. Without the stabbing, and along with her other interpretive choices, Weld condemned Duke's Carmen as theatrical without being dramatic, attractive but not seductive. It savors more of a pretty and coquettish sales lady in a large dry goods house than a working girl in a Spanish cigarette factory. You, clearly upset by Weld's review, responded in an impassioned letter to the editor of a Boston paper. In it, she defended her interpretation by claiming to have studied the score and Mérimée's novella. She believed the composer intended Carmen should be a creature of strong contrasts, so she chose to emphasize her higher moments as well as her unrestrained vagaries. In an interview, she declared, "Unless I can play Carmen without affronting the modesty of any woman in the audience, I will abandon the part." However, you could not withstand the public criticism. She did not abandon the part, but the papers reported that by the end of the season, she had reverted to the traditional performance. So there's all these reviews that say, "Oh, I read that she had this crazy Carmen, but it's perfectly normal." So she changed everything back. One reason American authors may have thought the stabbing was part of the original staging is that they may not have seen the work without it. Minnie Hauk may have done this, or Hauk, I don't know how you say her name. She may have originated the staging and brought it with her to the U.S. There's one review of Hauk's performance, and there are a lot of them, but there's one review from the New York premiere that mentions the stabbing in passing. The author uses it to impress upon his readers how horrible Carmen is. She is saved from prison by a good man, whom she allures into loving her, and then she flouts him and even tries to stab him because he is jealous. Thus, Hauk seems to have performed the stabbing in the U.S., and she was also the model for all other American Carmens until Emma Calvey performed the role at the Metropolitan in 1893. So Tamara said that was seemed to say that was Minnie Hauk's idea, but it is almost impossible to read a long review of Carmen before Emma Calvey that does not say either she was better or worse or different or something about Hauk. Everyone compared her to. So I don't think that was just Hauk's idea. I mean, that was clearly the critic's idea as well. Even Clara Louise Kellogg, who sang Carmen in the other 1878 American production, first saw the opera in London in that Her Majesty's Italian Opera production with Hauk in the role. The papers reported that Kellogg and her mother took copious notes while watching the performance, which then formed the basis of the Strakosch Company's production. So there's this big thing in the papers about how Strakosch has basically stolen it, and that only Mapleson had permission from Schudenz to actually do the opera, and that Schudenz said that was true, and there was this just lots and back and forth about that. Well, I don't know when some of the performance practices I've described fell out of favor. The Widmark stage manager scores might hold clues to a later post-World War I interpretation. In addition to the altered stabbing, those sources indicate that the first course of Act 4 is normally omitted, but that a ballet could be interpolated at that point. So maybe that guide was designed for a very large company that traveled with ballet dancers and children, which were much more common after World War I, or for residential troops that didn't need to worry about transporting all those extra people. Also, the Widmark scores in general have fewer cuts, and many more of them have been reversed than some of the other sources. Additionally, of course, the scores were not printed until after 1910, and the two post-1923 scores don't have any staging instructions in them, so I don't know what they did. But both scores also have relatively few alterations, but they do contain some of the cuts I've just outlined to you. The alterations I've outlined and others that I've not had time to discuss create a different picture of the opera than we might see today, one with a more violent but still sexually suggestive title character, a less emasculated Don José. My reading of these scores and the earliest American critical reaction to the opera reveals that the performance of Carmen changed after the work premiered in ways that accentuated and extended the prevailing critical response to the opera. From the American 19th century point of view, Carmen was fatally flawed. Her disloyalty and immorality represented a grave threat to the patriarchal hierarchy and the decorum expected of women at that time, a decorum already under threat in the US as more and more women entered the workforce and demanded the vote. Don José, meanwhile, becomes a cautionary tale. He was a soldier with everything going for him until a woman abdicated her proper role and unleashed in him the immorality and violence lurking just below the surface. On a more global level, Carmen's American performance offers insight into the issues of operatic adaptation and a cultural transfer and the transatlantic journey of European music to the United States. I hope that this conference, as I said yesterday, can serve as a catalyst for more work of this type to be conducted on other iconic operas, so that we can begin to understand whether and how local political, social, and musical conditions created regional operatic performance practice.
I think we couldn't agree more on the vitality of staging. You already in the earliest years that were performed.
Yeah.
So I was thinking, what about, because you have all these materials, Michaela has all the materials, I found some, we should create some big juxtaposition, some spreadsheet, left table,
with the
libretto text, then A is the 1875 mise en scène.
That would be amazing.
That would be very interesting to see
where,
what they do and why and...
Yeah. Absolutely.
And cuts and so on. So
I don't know if you noticed, just to make sure everyone realized, some of these scores are online now. So I've given you the URL, and they've got all the orchestral parts and a selection of these scores online. So you can go see them if you're just dying to.
By the way, the same goes for a lot of Monet materials that were kept in the city archives of Brussels.
Uh-huh.
Thanks to Brigham Young University, a lot of it has been digitized and made available on archive.org.
Mm-hmm.
They're often difficult to search, so you have a lot of things coming up for a single search, but it's very interesting what comes up there.
Yeah, I bet.
So some questions.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Absolutely extraordinary.
Thank you.
I can't believe that you had access to all these scores. I wish I could. I'm just a little unsure. So they would have hired the score from this, and then they gave it back at the end.
Yes.
But they're allowed to mark it up.
Yes. Yes. So when you look at a whole score, you'll get like that one page. There's blue markings, there's red, there's pen, there's pencil, there's stuff erased, there's things that are pinned together, like pages that are still pinned together, or you can see the holes where they took the pins out, you can see the erasures, you can see where they put paper clips and then they took them out, or sometimes the paper clips are still there and they get all rusted, right? So you can see the rust from them. So that's what I mean about reversed cuts. Like you'll see that the paperclip was taken out, and then there's markings where they must have cut it at some point because someone had turned the page, and it was there long enough that it made a mark. It wasn't like, you know, they had it for 3 weeks and then they took it off and gave it back or something. It was there. And the other thing I'd like to say is, based on the whole production, like the whole collection, which has thousands of productions, I mean, it's an enormous collection, there seem to be certain companies that were so famous that it was the casino production of X, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the Bostonians, which is a very important troupe, they didn't do it very much, but the Bostonians was a big deal. And so I think the Bostonians, that was like the version people did if they wanted the Bostonians version, when people still remembered the Bostonians. I think what happened is they would write Tams Woodmark and say, I want the Bostonians version, because that's another one that doesn't have a whole lot of changes in it. I mean, there's a lot of changes, but then they're not modified again. So that's sort of the best I can do.
Surely those scores were actually on sale by that time.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
It's very easy to. I mean, somebody. I've never looked at them all because it wasn't of any concern in that.
Right.
In that edition.
Yeah, of course.
But looking at them, the print of the Metzler score is exactly the same as the Novella score.
Oh, is it?
Later on, because I think, I haven't got the details here, that Novella was taken over by Metzler.
Metzler
was taken over by Novella.
Mm-hmm.
But some of the captions in it look completely different.
Really?
So there is a process of evolution going on, maybe within Metzler itself.
Yeah.
And then on to Novella. I mean, the mistake in the chorus of boys.
Yeah.
It's not a chorus of boys, it's a chorus of
children. Yeah.
And you can tell the plates from Metzler to Novello because of the crotch it rests. The
okay,
rests
yeah.
are the old-fashioned reverse quaver rests.
Mm-hmm.
Have you got a pen? For the
those
board.
Are boards. There might be one there.
I
might not.
Yeah,
I
so I didn't delve into any of that, right? I just sort of took the, I was like, oh, look, here's some.
Well,
yeah.
your example of the high A going
yeah.
down to
yeah,
the B,
yeah, yeah.
it would be interesting to compare those between all the scores.
Yeah.
This is, that's Metzler and Novello crotchet rest. And then the next one was Ditson.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
Ditson does what nobody's allowed to do these days, dotted rests.
Hmm.
Which would now, and I didn't see a page of that, but the normal thing would be to do that. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then Schirmer has got proper crotchet rests.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
they're all very different.
Yeah.
But it seems to me that they tampered with these, maybe from American editions to English ones. So,
yeah.
so to go through every
yeah.
page wouldn't take long.
Yeah.
But to
yeah.
see the variants all
right,
the way through
yeah.
those would be very interesting.
Well, and the Metzler, I think I told you, the final number, that part that I was telling you about that got all cut up, right? That A flat run is not even printed in the Metzler. There's this part in the middle that's just all different. There's a new Carmen, there's a couple of lines of Carmen that is not in the rest of the scores. That A flat run's gone.
But then singers might turn up from having done it with one score, like they still
right,
do, like
right.
they did at Braden.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
they say, no, I do it that way. I
well, yes, and that, and I wondered if that's why the A-flat run was marked out in some, because they had either learned it or had heard it without it, and was like, well, what's this, and marked it
mm-hmm.
out. Yeah.
But I wonder whether the Ditson score actually went back to the Shugarts.
Yes, the Ditson score. I did compare the music of the Ditson score.
Yeah.
I didn't even think about what the rest looked like, but I did. But musically, in terms of notes and stuff, it's
yeah.
basically identical.
Yeah.
But the Metzler is different. Yeah.
I had a short
yeah,
comment
oh, sure.
about the stabbing.
Yeah.
Because we've been talking, of course, about the authenticity towards the Merry Men,
mm-hmm.
and I remember you were saying yesterday that you had a sense that Merry Men had quite an imagination. And one type of woman or one myth attached to women that is reoccurring in his writing is the figure of the woman with a knife in her stocking.
Oh
and
my goodness.
Yes.
Huh.
Comes here and there.
Huh.
And I don't know if there could have been, because
yeah.
we've been discussing about other sources.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that came into that parody. With Opera Comique, the whole thing was that she had a knife in her
huh.
garter.
Yeah, I thought about
you know,
that. Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
But she doesn't use it on Jose in the novel.
No.
She uses it on a few English soldiers.
yeah, interestingly, yeah.
I feel
yeah.
Was attached to.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah, yeah, that's fascinating.
And
yeah.
which he, as it was local to Madrid, I think in his writing, he then speaks about women in the Mediterranean. Links to other myths about Italian women, and it's quite a theme.
Yeah.
Think.
Oh, I didn't know that.
We're discussing other types of sources that might inform local production.
Yeah.
Perhaps
yeah.
somebody was familiar with that, or maybe
it certainly could have been.
Else.
Yeah.
It's just a look.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
no, that's really interesting. Yeah.
Well, there's no doubt. I mean, she would have used a knife because she.
And she sends a knife with the bread.
File.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting also what you talked about, the portrayal of Don José, because I actually think we get very obsessed with Carmen herself,
yeah.
but the change in Don José is a very interesting thing.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael made a comment about this, and I have a comment about it myself. I was very curious when you talked about the review of Fernando de Lucia,
mm-hmm.
and that incredibly emotional performance, and I wonder if there's any coincidence about that fact that he's Italian and it's 1894, and that beginning of a change in the way José is played,
right, right.
which we see, you know, much
right.
more into the 20th century with Caruso and maybe Fleck, and you know, following on through. And I'll just
yeah.
finish with
yeah,
Michael's
yeah,
point
yeah.
so you can respond to all the
yeah.
José stuff at once. He was also asking, does the Civil War and a generation of soldiers
mm-hmm.
and all of that, does that affect an American need to defend the soldier and create that character in a much stronger way? Because, you know, the Spaniards
yeah.
really had a problem with just say,
yeah.
you know, as a mummy's boy and And I'm just wondering if there's a different but similar defense of the character in this new reinterpretation of it.
Right. So let me think if I can have. So I'll start with the last part first. So I don't think it's the Civil War. It's Theodore Roosevelt. Okay. So at the turn of the 20th century in America, led by comments that Theodore Roosevelt and others made in the sort of late 1880s, early 1890s, there was this huge concern that American men were being sissified. That's what he called it. And one of the big things that he complained about was that men were going to music too much, and that music, and they knew music, and that music was this agent of emasculation. So there was all this rhetoric about men and about they needed to be manly so there's always, of course, been this women are hysterical but men are emotional, you know, thing. But that really gets played up. So I think that Hackett's response to Du Lucia is part, and if you read that, it's about 8 pages long, and it's only about that performance and about Jean Jaussez as a character. It's an amazing review. You can find that edition. It's online on internetarchive.org maybe, or Hi-Fi Trust, that issue of music. So if you want the citation, I can give it to you. But anyway, he goes on and on about how he's a strong Spanish peasant, and he sounds like, if you, instead of saying Spanish, if you said American Midwesterner, that's exactly how he's described, as the strong farmer type who is led astray by the horrible Carmen. So I think that's the American context of that sort of language. Yeah. Now, the fact that he's Italian and all of those things, certainly he could have changed his, you know, that helped with his way of wanting to rehabilitate Don José. Mm-hmm. I think for me, what's striking, going to your first point, and is that how little they talk about Don José in the earlier reviews, because I do think they're like, oh my God, this man's awful, right? What do we say about him? Right, so you'll get lots and lots of talking about Carmen, lots about Mikhail, but maybe a little less. Couple sentences about how great Escamillo is and how manly he is, and then Capanini sang the flower song very well, and they just don't talk about Don José at all. But the thing that's really interesting to me, as well, is Carmen is the only opera that I read reviews for lots of operas from the late 1870s until about 1910-ish. Carmen is the only opera that they kept talking about the story and the characters. All the others, within a month or so after the premiere, it was just this person sang well and this person doesn't, and I liked the new Carmens. But in Carmen, they're constantly returning and constantly continuing to talk about, which is why I started looking at Carmen to begin with, because there was information that was more interesting than she can sing it or she can't, or, you know, he looked, whatever. He fell off the stage and Minnie Hauck tried to attack him, or, you know, whatever. So, yeah, it's very different.
So fantastic to hear that in Roosevelt. It was a Roosevelt?
Yeah, Theodore Roosevelt.
Because that's
such
an old strand of thought going back to play, to Homer,
oh,
the
yeah.
sirens,
yeah.
mollifying man.
Yeah.
I've actually worked on that in the 18th century. For example, the Donne Abbandonata, which was one of the famous libretto in the 18th century, one of the few to have a tragic ending that was popular. And that was simply because Dido had to commit suicide because Aeneas could regain his manliness and found Italy.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
It's that old thought that was in the word mollify.
Sissification.
And
flats. I mean, it's a sort of, you can see it coming as a Trumpist sort of thing.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of it also in early 18th century London when the Italian opera came. Italian opera will mollify men, will turn them into, gays and all that.
Yeah.
Or because of the
One of the ways they talked about homosexuality in the New York press was musical men. They were called musical men. And the other thing that I should mention in that change, so that I got to read all these reviews, is as you get closer to the Spanish-American War, you get more and more that Carmen is Spanish and not a gypsy, because we're about to go to war with Spain, and also more and more talking about her as the sort of imagery that makes her seem like the evil, the Philippine or Spanish woman that needs to be rescued by the strong American soldier, right? They sort of start, and it's highly, much more sexualized than it was before. So, Emma Abbott, there's no indication of smoking in Emma Abbott's stage manager's production, but later on they talk about her smoking in the and that she should blow smoke and that kind of stuff. In those later scores, you start to see she starts to smoke. And so it's like, it's become, first she's more violent and then she gets sexier, right? it's interesting changes.
Okay, I think.
Did you have a question?
I think it's been so fascinating. I didn't want to ask this boring question. What you described with these editions that get returned.
It's a
palimpsestic process.
Yes.
I just wondered, are you confident that it's easy to disentangle the various layers, or is it a bit ambiguous at times?
Well, so I try to be in my dissertation more open about it than I had time in this. I have made the assumption that cuts are probably earlier than, well, they have to be earlier than erasures, obviously, because there's something to be erased, but that it was cut more, the older, like if I'm trying to excavate an older performance, that it's cut more than a newer performance would be. And I tried to work out which cuts did I see the most often in the most number of sources. So like the cuts that I gave you are in all of them. Now they might start 10 measures earlier or end 5 measures different. I mean, they might be of different lengths, but they're all there. And either, and then when you get to the erasures, either they're never erased or you get like 5 or 6 different versions of that cut, and then they're all erased, right? So that's how, so am I confident that I can tell you exactly what Emma, I mean, I'm pretty good about Emma Abbott, but like what the Bostonians did, because they're, no. But because it's possible that maybe they erased some of them and then put them back, and that, you know, like I don't know which, and maybe they just didn't bother to erase them and they didn't actually do them. So no, I can't be perfectly confident, but I feel confident that there was a set of cuts that were done a lot. And I feel confident that those first 5 scores, I feel confident when they were first used, if I'm right, that those names are not just someone like writing their name on the score and forgetting it, they didn't own it, right? If I'm right that they actually owned those scores, then that's some kind of dating before 18, you know, that it's not 18, doesn't come from 1878 anyway, you know? So. I don't know how to be 100% sure. But that's the best that I could do. Let's put it that way. I felt, so I actually had the medievalist and early Renaissance John Nottish was on my committee just so he could help me with this, because it's like looking at medieval and Renaissance manuscripts, right, and trying to figure out how to deal with it. And he, you know, I will, the higher authority of John Nottish, he said he believed me, so I was able to convince him. So that's my only authority is John Nottish. So.
I think David will take
that. No, I think it's a really important question, because I could be making all of this up. Like this could all be a figment of my imagination, right? But I've tried to be pretty rigorous about my methodology, just so that I feel confident about what I'm saying, that I'm seeing what I'm seeing and I haven't made it up, you know. The first time I saw those Emma Uke letters and that, I didn't know about any of this. I hadn't seen the scores yet. I'm like, what the hell is he talking about? You know, I had no idea. And it wasn't until I saw those scores that I realized that they were talking about the stabbing. Because it's not mentioned very often. It's very rare. But they obviously did it.
I think it's worth, we talk to Paul and we'll look at Ken's thesis and the stuff on that. I mean, I don't remember it coming up in the Hawke reception in London at all, but whether it comes in once she gets to New York, it's always really trawling through that, which I certainly haven't done.
Yeah.
And just seeing where it emerges.
Right, it's only in that one review of at least 20 of the New York premiere.
Very curious.
But it's in that one, so did they just... To me, what that means is it just seemed like, of course she would try to stab him because she's a horrible person, right? And so why would you bring that out in particular? It just seemed, that was my reasoning for why they wouldn't...